Tribal trails, tribal trails. The Son of God, he's near. He chose to walk with us. These tribal trails.
I was born and raised in Moose Factory, Ontario, up in James Bay.
Okay.
In a town, village called Moose Factory, the Moose Cree First Nation.
Oh, okay. Large village?
Yeah, it's about 2,500 people maybe that live there.
Oh, okay.
Many others that are on our registry list. But
yeah. And what's it like?
Well, it's a isolated community.
Oh, okay.
And but very beautiful too, because we're just at the southern tip of James Bay. And a lot of rivers flow into James Bay, so just a very beautiful area.
Tell me what your life was like.
It was a Christian upbringing, but my mom and dad were hunters, trappers.
You said they were Christians right at the very beginning?
Well, when I was 3 years old, when my mom became a Christian.
Oh, okay.
My dad a year later when I was 4 years old. Okay. So I grew up learning about God and about Jesus, going to Sunday school.
The broad road, the Bible tells us, and many people are walking on that road. That's where I was. I walked on that road and the Lord saved me. So thankful to say today that he put me on the narrow road that leads to life, eternal life. And then from there, you know, I kept on as the Lord all these years. And I guess the greatest burden I had when I came to know the Lord, after I came to understand the Word of God, is my children. I thought about them a lot. I would have to live an example life before their eyes. My testimony, I would have to live for them. My wife and I, we're two Christians, I guess, for 10 years, I guess, before we see any of our children came to know the Lord. We were just two Christians in our home. And we lived for the Lord, and we had all these things going. Like, we were taught how to bring up our children, how to have devotions with them, to share the Word of God with them. We did all that. And then we were wondering why nothing was happening. But I guess we... the Lord's timing is always best, I guess.
Direct your children onto the right path, and when they are older, they will not leave it.
Did that have an effect on your life?
Oh yeah, it had a real effect on my life.
Okay.
I didn't embrace that path early in my life and even into my early teenage years. It chose to...
Oh, okay.
Deviate from the really walking in that direction.
Okay. What made you change?
I think it was the love of Jesus that I saw through my mom and dad.
Okay.
My mom and dad were very good parents. Mm-hmm. They really loved us. There's one type of love that they showed me that I never forgot. It's called unconditional love.
Yeah.
They love you no matter what.
Yeah.
Especially in the years when I was living wildlife.
No, okay.
Mom and Dad would still love me. Yeah. They'd correct me too, but they loved me at times when I really didn't deserve it. They loved me when I was really hurting.
Hmm.
And I never forgot that. And that basically really changed my life.
Yeah.
Don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can't you see that his kindness is intended to turn you from your sin?
Before I accepted the Lord, when I was in the hospital, they used to tell us about Bible stories.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't remember what kind of stories really they told us at that time. But this one verse in the Bible that she shared with us, I never forgot it, never forget it. All my teenager life to the young, right up to this day. And I live with that verse. But I didn't understand until I came to know the Lord. It's a very familiar verse that everybody likes. It's John 3:16. I'll read it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. I really believe this verse is really stand out in my witness. In my witness to my children and to others. Because God loved the world, that he gave us his only Son. Can you imagine how it tells somebody? Give us his only Son. And if we believe in him, we're not going to be perished or be destroyed by Satan. But we're going to have, but God is going to give us everlasting life, eternal life.
But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners.
I was 16 years old the day I invited Jesus Christ to come into my life.
Okay. Was there anything specific that convicted you, a scripture verse or a reason why you said, I've got to give my life to the Lord?
I think it was just a whole message that I heard since I was young. Mm-hmm. That Jesus came to this earth.
Yeah.
To die for each and every one of us. And to even die for our sins. Mm-hmm. And even up to that point already in my life, I committed a lot of wrongdoing.
Yeah.
Committed a lot of sins, and already I was tired of the way I was living already at that age. I was always an extreme kind of guy in everything that I do in life, and living that life, I lived it to the extreme too.
Live fast.
Yeah, and then I just came to a point where I just didn't want that life. I was going downhill.
Yeah.
It was destroying me, really, and I don't think I would have survived much longer if I would have kept on that path.
Yeah.
Because I was such an extreme guy. Mm-hmm. So it was really God's love through my parents, I think, that I saw.
Yeah.
That I knew that God loves me, despite of all that I've done. Mm-hmm.
Did you come to the Lord on your own or in church? Or?
No, it was actually in my mom and dad's bedroom.
Oh, what was it?
Yeah.
Nice.
I just told them I wanted to give my life to Jesus, so they took me in a room and I bowed there.
With your mom and dad?
Bowed at the edge of their bed, and I asked God to forgive me of all my sins, and I invited Jesus into my life.
Yeah.
Really, I like to say Jesus came to me and offered me a better life.
Did he?
He sure did. It's in the Bible, John 10:10. Jesus said, Thief comes but to steal and to kill and to destroy. And then Jesus says, I came that you might have life and that you might have it to the full. That's been my experience the past 42 years.
Yeah.
As I've experienced life to the full.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the water lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me. Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me.
long after that did you meet Caroline?
Well, we were already dating at that time.
Oh, were you?
Okay. Yeah, we were already seeing each other.
Yeah.
And we were already, don't think we ever talked about Christianity or about Jesus until mm-hmm. after. Mm-hmm. When I told her what I did.
Yeah. Caroline, you were raised in Moose Factory also?
In Moosonee.
In Moosonee?
Just across the river, so yeah.
Oh, okay. Tell me what your life was like.
I think I grew up in a good home. My parents were loving, good parents. It wasn't a Christian home, but they sent us to church every Sunday, sometimes three or four churches. You know, just really wanted us, I guess, to learn about God, and that was important to them. I learned a lot going to Sunday school, and used to go to their youth groups, and we did Bible correspondence courses and things like that. So I knew about God, I guess, in my head, and had that knowledge about the scriptures and what God's love was like, but didn't really know that experientially, I guess, in my heart at that point in time when I was young. And so, yeah. But I never forgot those things that I was taught, you know, in scripture and, yeah.
Since we believe that Christ died for all, we also believe that we have all died to our old life. He died for everyone so that those who receive his new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ, who died and was raised for them.
Merv accepted the Lord when he was 16.
Yeah.
Did you notice that? Were you going with him then?
I was going with him then, yeah. And I noticed something was different right away. And we had talked one time previously, but it was in a situation where we were doing things that we probably shouldn't have done, and we were kind of fearful in that situation, you know. And he told me at that point that he had gone to church and was thinking about accepting the Lord. And I told him that I had accepted the Lord when I was younger too, you know. But we had never talked about it, what that really meant. And at that point, so it was just a very brief conversation. Yeah, but I did notice the change in him when he did accept the Lord. And
what did you think of that?
I thought it was great. Like, you know, it was something that I think I had always wanted to, you know. And for myself, I accepted the Lord when I was 12 years old at a youth gathering at the pastor's house. We would meet during the week, play games and stuff. But so I gave my heart to the Lord there. Mm-hmm. And probably 6 or 7 months later, I went out to high school. So it was a real struggle, like you were without your parents or without family. And so I ended up falling back, I guess, and doing the things that my friends were doing and not continuing on with the Lord, you know. So, but I always wanted to walk with the Lord. I think I always had that desire.
Yeah. So you graduated from high school. You were going to school where?
In Timmins,
and then you went back home?
Yeah.
And is that when you got married?
Yeah. Yeah, we got married about 6 months after I graduated from high school, so we were young.
Yeah. How young?
I had just turned 18, and he was 19, yeah.
Okay.
All my heart to him I give, ever to him I'll cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best song. Faithful loving service to him belong. Love lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love. help. Love lifted me.
Merv, the first time my husband and I met you was at K601 Bible School in Alberta. Mm-hmm. Tell me how you got there.
Well, we were just married about 8 months when I got a call from the principal then, Bill Friesen.
Oh, okay.
I guess the K601 Bible Institute were planning to enter a hockey team in the league that year in Lac La Biche. And I remember Bill Friesen calling me one day and saying, would you like to come to Bible school and also play hockey at the same time? And so hockey was a big thing in my life at that time.
So word got around you were a hockey player.
Yeah. My brother had attended there the year before and was a good hockey player too.
Oh, okay.
And so that really attracted me because I loved hockey. And so me and my cousin, he got the same phone call and we both went off.
Steve,
my cousin Steve. Yeah. And we both went off to Bible school a couple of weeks later after that phone call.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
All scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip His people to do every good work.
How was Bible school?
It was a good experience.
Okay.
We really enjoyed studying the Bible. And sometimes we people don't like the Bible, but yet they don't really know what it says and the message in there. And I really enjoyed studying and then, of course, meeting all the new friends that I met from across the country. And
yeah.
Also meeting the staff like yourself and Lyle and others. And it was a very good experience. We have precious memories. We have made lifetime friends.
Caroline, what did you think of Bible school?
I really enjoyed it too. I think I went full time the first year, and then our son Jonathan was born after that summer. So I went part time the last 2 years, but really enjoyed the courses and learning. I think we were both really hungry to learn a lot and to study the Bible. And
Tell me something that you learned in Bible school, Caroline.
I think just God's faithfulness, that you know that we can count on on God, you know, in spite of our unfaithfulness sometimes, you know, that He is always there and He's always going to be working in our lives and drawing us back to Himself when we do stray, you know, and that we can count on Him no matter, because we are so happy and it's easy to say God is good when we're on a mountaintop experience, when things are going well in life, you know, but when we struggle, you know, that to realize that God is always there too, and we can have joy in those times too in spite of the struggles.
Hold an angel up above, Jesus completely saved. He will lift you by His love out of the angry wave. He's the master of the sea, billows His will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me.
After you graduated from K601, what did you do?
I went back home to Moose Factory, 1982.
Oh, okay.
And started helping out in the church there in Moose Factory.
Oh, okay.
I was on the leadership team there.
Oh, okay.
Helping in a leadership role.
Okay.
Then I also got a job.
Okay.
And worked during that time there. Mm-hmm. Eventually, in 1986 to 88, I went back to Bible College.
Where?
In at Briarcrest Bible College.
Oh, okay.
Seminary in Saskatchewan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And graduated there in 88 with my bachelor's in pastoral studies.
Oh, okay.
And then in 1988, after I was done, literally when I walked off the train, I started pastoring my home church in Moose Factory, the Cree Gospel Chapel.
Oh, okay.
Joshua summoned all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and said, "So fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshipped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt. Serve the Lord alone. But if you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates? Or will it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live? But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord."
You had struggles with hockey. Do you want to talk about that?
I loved hockey, probably more than a lot of things in life.
Yeah.
Sometimes it would interfere in my life, especially my spiritual life.
Yeah.
Because you know what I've learned is that when you put Jesus first in your life, mm-hmm. and everything else falls into place, and you enjoy everything else to the fullest.
Yeah.
And there's times you like things more sometimes, mm-hmm. you know, and your struggles in life. And I've learned that lesson. Mm-hmm. I've come to a point early in my Christian life that I wanted God to have first place in my life and to rule my life in every area. Sometimes it's a scary thought, but
yeah.
I mean, I surrendered my life a year after I became a Christian, where I said yes to God in everything, and my life's been really awesome. I have no complaints. If I had to do it all over, I'd really do it again, because it's been an awesome life.
Mm-hmm.
The Christian life is the best life to live.
Heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, his precious blood's atoning. And I repented of my sin and won the victory. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me, he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved the air I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the crimson flood. I heard about his healing, cleansing power revealing. He made the lame to walk again. He caused the blind to see. Then I cried, "Dear Jesus, heal my broken spirit." And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me whole with his redeeming blood. He loved the air I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Heard about thy mansion built for me in glory. I heard about streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing an old redemption story. Some sweet day I want to sing up there, well now a song about victory. Victory in Jesus, the Savior forever. He saw me, then he bought me whole with his redeeming blood. He loved the air I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.